So before we start our service, let's just bow our hearts and speak to our God. Father God, thank you so much for this day, for giving us a desire to come here, to hear your word, to be filled up with your love and your goodness, God. Lord, we just ask that you help us to just put aside all those cares and concerns that we might have, Lord, things that we pick up during the week that kind of hold us down in anxiety and worry. We just ask that you allow us to put that aside so we can just receive and be in your presence today, God. We just want to be filled up with your word, God. And we ask that you just change us today, Lord. Help us to become more like you. Lord, we're so grateful that your love endures forever. And we appreciate all the good things you do in our lives, Lord. And we just ask that today you touch those that need your help, Lord, those who are suffering with COVID or anything that might be keeping them from having joy. Lord, we ask that you fill them with joy regardless of what they might be experiencing today. Let them know that you will not leave them nor forsake them, that you have this covered, Lord, and that your love does endure forever, and that you are faithful, and that you'll get us through whatever trial comes before us, God. So thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you for giving us this day. Thank you for giving us hope for the future, a bright future, Lord. And we know that this is going to be a good season coming up. And we're so grateful that you are our God, Lord. Lord, just encourage us. Continue to sustain us in this place, Lord, so we can just come here and raise our hands and worship to you, Lord. We're grateful. We love you. In Jesus' name. Let's all stand.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. He is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise. With a mighty hand and outstretched arm, his love endures forever. For the life that's been reborn, his love endures forever. We sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever God is faithful, forever God is strong, forever God is with us. Forever God is faithful, forever God is strong, forever God is with us, forever, forever.
From the rising
to the setting sun, his love endures forever. And by the grace of God, we will carry on. His love endures forever. We sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever God is faithful, forever God is strong, forever God is with us, forever,
forever,
forever God is faithful, forever God is strong, forever God is with us, forever, forever.
Thank you, Lord. We need to think of God as our friend. We need to think of him as someone who really cares about us. You know, not someone who's waiting there and waiting to discipline us and beat us up, but he's our friend.
That you are mindful of me, that you hear me when I call. And is it true that you are thinking of me, how you love me? It's amazing, so amazing. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend.
Sing it out. I'm a friend.
I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. Who am I that you are mindful of me, that you hear me when I call? And is it true that you are thinking of me, how you love me? It's amazing, so amazing. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. God Almighty, Lord of glory, you have called me friend.
God Almighty,
God Almighty, Lord of glory, you have called me friend. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend.
Think about that.
I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, God.
And he doesn't ask us to become anything that we're not, except just a follower of him, because he's a good, good father. The world will make up stories about why you can't be a Christian or a believer. It's too strict, it's too rigid, it's this, it's that, but it's very simple. You just put your hands in his, you put your life into his hands, and you let him lead. And you'll have eternal life. It's that simple. Make him your Lord and Savior today. Jesus, come into our lives right now, Lord. We ask you, be our Savior. We need you now.
Well, I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whispers of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. 'Cause you're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Oh, well, I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say your word. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. 'Cause you're perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. I can hardly speak. Peace so unexplainable. I can hardly think as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still into love, love, love. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. 'Cause you're perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us.
And perfect you are, Lord. How amazing. And you could tolerate our imperfection, but and accept us and receive us the way we are. That you could save a wretch like me.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains. Unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope, secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. My chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains. Unending love, amazing grace. Shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine. But God, who called me here below, will be forever mine.
You are forever mine.
Amen. And Lord, that is the blessed hope, Lord, that You are always with us, Lord. As we journey in this life, Lord, we know that You are near, an ever-present help in times of trouble, Lord. And we thank You for this opportunity to sing to You, for You alone are worthy, Lord, of all the honor and the praise and the glory, God. So we come to You this morning, Lord, with all of our cares, Lord, with all of our excitement, Lord, things that You're doing in our life that just blows us away, Lord. But we acknowledge and we know that this life has troubles in it, Lord. So we pray for those that are hurting, especially we pray for the Johns family, Lord. We ask that You would protect them and keep them, especially Mr. Phil, as he went to his daughter's house, Lord. We pray that he would be strengthened there and that he would just feel better, Lord. Bring him through this time. We ask that You protect Nina, God, and just keep the virus from her, Lord. Be with the whole family, Lord, in this time. We also, Lord, want to pray for the Petrie family. We want to hold to you Miss Deanne, Lord, and ask that you would fill her with hope and encourage her heart, Lord, and that you would just give her strength, Lord, to keep walking with you. Be with John, her husband. Be with the rest of the Petrie family, Lord, in this time. We know it's hard for them, but I pray that you would just send your spirit and encourage their hearts today. We also want to pray for Chuck, God, this morning and his family, especially at the loss of their son, Stephen, Lord. We ask that you would encourage the family at this time, God. We pray that you would fill them with your hope and comfort. Fill them with your Holy Spirit, Lord. Bring them through this time. And may they, Lord, eventually in time, Lord, just have their hearts healed. And we thank you for the friendships that you've sent to Chuck and the family at this time, Lord, to strengthen them, to hold them up through this you know, very difficult time, Lord. And the rest of us, we all pray, Lord, that you would heal our bodies for those of us that are hurting, God, and our minds that are discouraged, God. We hold them to you, Lord. We pray for those that are sick with all various diseases, Lord. We hold it all to you because we know that you're ultimately the great physician. You're the great healer, Lord. You are our comforter. You are our encouragement. So we thank you this morning, Lord, that we can run to you and that you're never far away and that you never leave us on the road alone. We're so grateful to learn that today. So we thank you, Lord. Thank you for this time of fellowship. We thank you for all those that worked so hard yesterday cleaning up the property, God. We thank you for all the help that we have here. We just love you, Lord. We thank you for another opportunity to read your word, to hear from you. And as always, Lord, we pray for the Holy Spirit that he would lead us and walk us through the word of God. We thank you for this morning again. In Jesus' precious name we all pray. Amen. Amen. Good morning.
Good morning.
Everybody can give the high sign. Hello, everybody. Good to have you. If you'd work your way over to the Gospel of Luke, we're going to be in chapter 24. I was very encouraged to hear Dave, Pastor Dave, went to my wife last week, and he goes, what's going on? We missed the last few verses of chapter 23. And I deliberately went over that so that we can go into that on Good Friday. So, saving that text for Good Friday. So, but we'll look at chapter 24. We're going to pick up at verse 13. So Jesus has risen from the dead. He has stepped out of the tomb to prove that he is God. And now he appears to two disciples on the road to Emmaus. Verse 13. Now behold, two of them were traveling that same day to a village called Emmaus, which was 7 miles from Jerusalem. And they talked together of all these things which had happened. And so it was, while they conversed and reasoned, that Jesus himself drew near and went with them. But their eyes were restrained so that they did not know him. And he said to them, what kind of conversation is this you have with one another as you walk and are sad? And then the one whose name was Cleopas answered and said to him, are you the only stranger in Jerusalem? And have you not known the things which happened there in these days? And Jesus said to them, well, what things? So they said to him, the things concerning Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty indeed, in word before God and all the people, and how the chief priests and our rulers delivered him to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we were hoping that it was he who was going to redeem Israel. Indeed, besides all this, today is the third day since these things happened. Yes, and certain women of our company who arrived at the tomb early astonished us when they did not find his body, they came saying that they had also seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. And certain of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but him they did not see. And then he said to them, Jesus said to them, "O foolish ones, slow of heart to believe in all that the prophets had spoken. Ought not the Christ to have suffered these things and enter into his glory?" And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded to them in all the scripture the things concerning himself. Then they drew near up to the village and where they were going. And he indicated that he would go on, he would have gone further. But they constrained him, saying, "No, no, no, abide with us, for it is toward evening and the day is far spent." And he went in and stayed with them. And now it came to pass as he sat at the table with them that he broke bread, blessed it, and broke it, and gave it to them. And then their eyes were open, and they knew him, and he vanished from their sight. And they said to one another, "Did not our heart burn within us while he talked to us on the road and while he opened the scriptures to us?" So they rose that very hour and returned to Jerusalem and found the 11 and those who were with them gathered together, saying, "The Lord is risen indeed and has appeared to Simon." And they told about the things that had happened on the road and how he was known to them in the breaking of bread. Let's pray. Father, again, what an amazing opportunity to explore your word and to hear from you this morning. God, I pray that for all those that are saddened and discouraged here this morning, walking on a road called Emmaus, maybe their own road, and just beaten up from just hopes and expectations that have failed them. God, I pray that you would lift them this morning to a new place, to know that you have done what no one has ever done, come out of the grave, and you promise us eternal life to those who look to you and believe in you, and a home that's eternal in the heavens that's not made with hands. And God, you promised us so many things. So we just pray this morning that we would all leave here encouraged and strengthened. Please go before us this morning. We hold our hearts to you. Do a new work in all of our lives. And we know you can do that because we ask that in the precious, holy, magnificent name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Amen. Amen. I'm excited to see the little crocuses coming up in the flower beds over here. Flowers are starting to come up. Spring has sprung, right?
Amen.
Amen. Springtime. Springtime. And what I love about springtime is, you know, summer's coming. We're going to get out of this COVID. We're going to get out of this virus eventually, right? It's coming. It's getting close. And I just can't wait to start traveling again. Going to see people I haven't seen in a year. You know, just to get out and the journey again, right? The journey to see things, see our beautiful country, maybe go away on vacation again. One of my favorite vacations for me personally is when we took a trip a couple years ago. We took a trip to Italy. We stopped off in Sicily, you know. Italy and Sicily are two different things, by the way. You know, if you're in Sicily, don't say you're in Italy. Right? The Sicilians don't like the fact that you call it Italy. It's not. It's Sicily. You're in Sicily. Arr. But I love the fact of traveling to new places. I loved our trip to Sicily. But what I loved the most about our trip to Sicily was the way we traveled. Well, the food, absolutely. That goes without saying. But the way we traveled. We traveled light. Dawn and I, we took one carry-on bag for the whole trip in Italy. She had a bag, I had a bag. We brought, that's all we brought. It was a summer, you don't need a lot of clothes. Well, we traveled unencumbered. We traveled light. And that's what made the journey so special to us. And you know what? The Bible would say to us the same thing. As we journey, as we travel in this thing called life, right? I think that's the same thing. God would call us to travel light. And Peter wrote to the church that was dispersed. Peter said in 1 Peter 2:11, he would say this about traveling light. He says, "Beloved, I beg you as how? Sojourners and pilgrims to abstain from worldly lusts," and so on and so forth. But the idea is that Peter calls us to sojourn. Peter calls us to pilgrim. The sojourner, the pilgrim, they travel light. They travel light in this world. And when I look at the scriptures and I think about what the Bible's saying to us, it's a pretty interesting thing that the Bible is all about a journey, is it not? When you think about the Old Testament, where was Israel going? The goal was to journey to what was called the Promised Land. When you look at the Old Testament, everybody was on a journey. Abraham was on a journey. The 12 tribes of Israel were on a journey. Everyone was on a journey. Old Testament pointed as a journey to the Promised Land. Well, New Testament, same thing. The New Testament calls us to be sojourners, pilgrims, on a journey. Where? To the kingdom of God. We're on a kingdom, we're on a road to the kingdom of God. God would call us to travel lightly in this world. Jesus taught us that he was on a journey, right? The journey of Jesus Christ was one that was on the move. He was always on the move. He wasn't very stationary, was he, right? He says in Matthew chapter 8, verse 20, Jesus says this about the journey that he was on. He says, "You know, guys, foxes have holes, birds of the air have nests. But the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head." Jesus didn't get encumbered trying to make a home here. He knew that his home was ultimately to be with his Father in heaven. So you think about that. What's Jesus' call to us as the church, right? To us today. Follow me. And keep moving. Follow me. Follow where I go. Journey to the places that I want you to journey to. You know, I believe one of our biggest reasons why we sometimes don't experience joy in this life, why we're so bummed out, why we're so discouraged, because we get bogged down with things that are really not essential. We've been talking about a lot of things that are essential, right? But we get weighted down, we get bogged down with things that are really not essential at the end of the day, right? Relationships, one to another, right? Our relationship with God, right? Jesus could hang Jesus was the master at making the complicated simple, right? He would say, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself." That's it. You do that, you're going to do well, right? The essentials, keeping it simple, journeying towards the kingdom of God. That's what it's all about. Don't get bogged down. Jesus would speak about, you know, the sower, right? And one of the places where the seed fell, when Jesus said, was in Mark 4:19, when he spoke about the cares of this world, right? The cares of this world, getting so encumbered with the things of this world. Jesus spoke about the deceitfulness of riches and the desire for other things that come into our life. And what does it do? It chokes. It chokes the word. And we become unfruitful. Getting weighted down in our journey. Losing focus. It's so easy for our journey with Jesus to get weighed down. Travel light. I would encourage us all to learn how to travel lighter in this world. And secondly, I think about the journey. The second thing about any journey is who we travel with. Journeys are great, but you got to be with the right person. It's great to travel with somebody. Sometimes we can't travel in this world with somebody. That's okay. But we always have the Lord to travel with us in our journey. And I think that's what the story is all about. Two disciples that are walking on the road, and they discover that they weren't alone at all. They were walking with Jesus. So in our journey, as we're looking at this, don't get bogged down, travel light, and know that we are not alone. Because these two here in verse 13, it says, behold, Luke records for us, now behold, two of them. Two of them, who? Disciples. We're going to look at this in a second. Not necessarily two men. Not necessarily. We're going to look at that for a second. But it says that two of them were traveling. Note, they were on a journey. Right? We're all on a journey. Either we're walking towards God or we're walking away from God. Right? That's how journeys are. And they were traveling, and I want you to note that the same day they were coming to a village called Emmaus, which was 7 miles from Jerusalem. I want to say that because it's not that they were walking to Jerusalem, they were walking away from Jerusalem. They were walking away, so to speak, from the things of God. They were walking away. They were dejected. And notice, as they were walking, we can either encourage each other in our talk or we can discourage each other. We can lift each other up in our words or we can tear each other down. Because that's what they were doing. As they talked, it says in verse 14, they talked as they were walking, right? About all the things which had happened. Jesus Christ. That's what they were talking about. The life, the death, the burial, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's what they were talking about. Can't believe it. Can't believe what happened. So it was, while they conversed and reasoned, they were trying to figure out in their own mind what in the world has just happened. As often happens to us, when something tragic happens, we start to go, whoa, what happened? What was that all about? Why did this happen to me? It's totally normal. It's totally natural. So they reasoned amongst themselves, and guess what? Verse 15 says, guess who comes next to them? Jesus Christ. Jesus said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Right? If I leave, it's better that I leave so that when I leave, I will give you who? The Comforter. The Comforter Jesus speaks about in the Gospel of John. Comforter, the Holy Spirit, the Paraclete, the one who comes alongside us. We are never alone on our journey. That's what this is speaking about. Jesus comes alongside them. Their eyes were restrained. They didn't recognize him. They didn't understand who this stranger was who comes alongside them. They did not know him, it says in verse 16. And Jesus says, what are you talking about? What kind of talk is this? What kind of talk? The kind that is depressing. The kind that is leading towards sadness, as it says the last word in verse 17. Why are you so sad? Jesus says to them. What kind of conversation is a sad conversation? It's a depressing conversation. It's not a conversation of hope. It's a conversation of sadness. It's over. We're talking about it being all over. Discouraged, defeated, and depressed Christians here. They're heavily burdened. Why? Because they're traveling with excess baggage of no hope. Their journey has a lot of baggage. They're filled with sadness. Now, it's quite possible these travelers were trying their best to reason from the scriptures, but they ended up in a sad state. They were discouraged. They were trying to work their way through it, but they were sad. They couldn't understand. What happened? It seems like a failure. Seems like a failure to them. Seems like Jerusalem will now have to continue being dominated by the Roman Empire. They were sad about that. They had hoped that Jesus was going to be their liberator from the bonds of Rome. They were already hoping that they could all see themselves and they're all in their position. Secretary of State, Secretary of Defense, you know, they could see that they were all going to have positions in the kingdom that was going to be established on the earth. They were all ready for that. But now it's over. Sadness has set in. And yet there's really no reason to be sad, is there? Why do I say that? Well, there is a report. There's a rumor that the tomb is empty. You see, everything about Christianity hinges on an empty tomb. Everything about our walk with God centers in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Everything. If we don't have the resurrection of Jesus Christ, we just have just another religious system. But you see, that's what makes Christianity different from everything else. We serve a God who came out of the grave. That changes everything. That's a game changer. That's the report that they should have heard. They should have heard. They should have listened to it. And really? The tomb is empty? Instead, they say, well, it's over. It's, you know, it's all done. We get to choose what we want to believe. And whatever you choose to believe, that's going to determine whether you're going to be a sad person or a happy person. What you choose. You see, these disciples, they chose to not believe that Jesus is risen from the dead. Even though he said, I'm going to be raised again. I'm going to come out of the tomb. They chose to not believe the report. Yet, these travelers could have easily have chosen to believe the report and have hope and get excited. Believe in the resurrection. Believe that Jesus Christ has rose from the dead. It'll change your life. It'll lighten your load. It'll lighten your load in your journey that we call life. Now, Cleopas, in verse 18, the one whose name was Cleopas answered and said to him. Now, it's interesting that in John chapter 19, verse 20, it says in the New King James Version that there were women who stood by the cross. This was at the cross of Christ. One was Jesus' mother. Another was Jesus' aunt, Mary's sister. And then it says Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. Other translations have it, the King James, the original King James, the Authorized Version, has it saying Cleopas. Cleopas. Mary, the wife of Cleopas. Now I say that because if this is who I think it might be, this is none other walking on the road than a couple, a married couple. Cleopas and Mary are walking. This is a couple who are walking together, leaving Jerusalem. And like so many, their hopes are dashed. All the Christians are feeling like it's a helpless situation. Maybe this is a married couple walking away from Jerusalem. But Jesus doesn't have it, does he? He says, what are you talking about? Why are you so sad? And they answer him and they said, are you the only one that didn't know what happened? Are you the only person to have not known the things which happened in the last few days? Seems like everyone was well aware and heard about the suffering and the dying and the placing of Jesus in the tomb. Everyone knows, but Jesus says, what things? In verse 19. I like that. Some people say Jesus didn't have a sense of humor. Jesus was always stoic. This is hilarious. I find this totally hysterical. Because the very things that happened to Jesus, he's asking them, what things? What has happened? I know Jesus laughed at this little thing here. I'm sure he giggled a little bit. What things? And you know, the one who is at the center of all these things that happened, he's asking what things? And they said, well, the things concerning Jesus of Nazareth. That was on their heart. The things concerning Jesus of Nazareth. Now, I want you to note the next three verses, what they say. And I wonder if you can notice. Because they say, concerning Jesus of Nazareth, verse 19, who was a prophet, mighty in deed, mighty in deed and word before God and people, and how the chief priests, you know, the rulers, they condemned him to death, verse 20, crucified him. But we were hoping that it was he who was going to redeem Israel. What do you find interesting? I find it very interesting that those are past tense words. Rather than saying Jesus, he is a prophet, mighty indeed. He is the Messiah. They could easily have been excited about Christ, that he's out of the tomb. We heard the tomb is empty. They could have said, he is the Messiah. And we are hoping. We are hoping in him. Our hope is in him. They could have been excited. Instead, they were saying, well, past tense. Jesus was a prophet. It's over now. We were hoping, all past tense things. I'm really grateful that Jesus is super patient with us. I'm really grateful for that. That as we walk in this life and we try to figure out this life that we're living, and we lose our hope sometimes. We lose the focus of the empty tomb. And we get discouraged. But yet I'm so grateful that Jesus walks alongside us and he tries to encourage. Like, what are you talking about? This is crazy talk. You ever hear somebody say, you're talking crazy. Jesus would say to us, every time we get bummed out in life, as though this is the end. Oh, it's all over. Oh, I thought you were there with me. Oh, I thought. Jesus would say to us, you're talking crazy. I'm alive. I'm alive. Well, don't get me wrong. We all get discouraged at times. I know what it's like to be discouraged and to feel like it's all falling apart. But we need to be reminded of these scriptures, guys. These Christians who were walking with Jesus, who called them to follow me. Do you know 19 times in the Gospels alone, Jesus speaking to disciples who were fishing, and Peter, and a rich young ruler, each time, follow me. Just follow me. We're not following a dead Messiah, we're following a risen Messiah, amen? And Jesus says, just follow me, just walk with me, trust me. Have your hope in me. But their hope was shattered, even though Jesus said, follow me. You know, it's real easy to get discouraged and disappointed when it seems God isn't doing as we had hoped he would do. It's so easy for us to fall into the past tense. Well, we thought he was one of those, and I thought you were the deliverer or whatever. Remember, guys. They saw Jesus performing miracles. They heard amazing teachers. And now it seems as though all is gone to them. But they were so wrong. Why are they so wrong? Because they laid out evidence why Christ is alive. They didn't believe Jesus at his word. Notice what they said in verse 21. They said it's the third day. Like, you would think that would like set off bells. Like, whoa, it's the third day. And he's not found at the tomb. This is good news, isn't it? No, not to them. They lost their hope. Verse 22, they said, there were certain women who went to the tomb, and it was astonishing to us. But verse 23, they did not find his body. Yeah, hello? Newsflash, this is all good news. It's not bad news. This is great news. Oh, they didn't find the body. See, it's the way they're looking at it. Visions of angels. Who said that he was alive? That should be good news. And certain of those who went to the tomb, they found it just as they said. You know, the Peter and John ran to the tomb. Some of those guys, they went, they saw it the same way, but no, but they're walking away from Emmaus. They're still bummed out. What did the two walkers on the road just say? There's evidence. There's evidence here. Women at the tomb found it empty. Angel said, what are you doing? He's not here. The other disciples went to the tomb. It's the third day. What more proof would they need? I wonder what more proof do we need? No, if I see it, I'll believe it. No, believe it and you'll see it. That's what God calls us to, believe. What more proof do they need? This is why Jesus said, man, you guys are, verse 25, so foolish. Foolish ones. It's foolish talking to act as though Jesus is dead. It's foolish discussion. And then he says, you're just slow of heart to believe in all that the prophets had spoken. They're slow to believe the prophecy of the book. Hundreds and hundreds of Old Testament prophecies coming true in the person of Jesus Christ. This should have been revelation to them. This should have been exciting to them. But they were slow of heart to believe all that the prophets had spoken. And then Jesus says in verse 26, you know I had to suffer. I told you. I told you about my suffering, the suffering. And then I can't even imagine this Bible study that Jesus shared, because he said, and then at beginning, Luke records, beginning at Moses, so beginning in Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, right on through the books of Moses, and then beginning at Moses and expounding all the prophets. Could you imagine that? Jesus expounded to these two disciples the scriptures, and what did the scriptures point to? It points to Jesus. It says he began to expound all the scriptures, the things concerning himself. The Bible is all about Jesus Christ. The Old Testament points forward to the cross, and the New Testament points back to the cross. It all points to Jesus Christ. Everything that we read in the scriptures, it should bring us to Christ. It concerns Jesus, this whole book that we read. I wonder if Jesus began in Psalm 40, verse 7, where it says, behold, I come in the scroll of the book. It is written of me. The psalmist predicted that the scroll of the book, or the entirety of the scriptures, pertain to who? Pertain to Jesus. Pertain to Messiah. And explaining how he is revealed in the Word of God. Jesus could spend the entire walk just discussing the third day with them alone. Could you imagine that Bible study? Jesus is explaining the Word of God to man. God. Maybe Jesus started in Genesis, in Genesis 1:11, where God said, let the earth sprout vegetation and plants and etc. And there was evening and morning. It was the third day. It's interesting that at the very beginning of creation, when life starts to sprout from the earth, living life, is on the third day. If you want to go to the second set of the third day, guess what? Guess what sprang from the dirt? God created what? Man. On the second set of third day. On and on and on. Throughout the scriptures, you could see all this about the third day. Jesus could have spent the whole time just speaking about that. Jesus could have took him to Genesis 22 when Abraham took his only son, Isaac, up to Mount Moriah, the very mountain where Jesus just died. And God says to Abraham, no, don't slay him. The angel stops Abraham from slaying his son and offering his son on Mount Moriah. And the Lord said, and I will provide myself a lamb. I will provide myself a lamb. But what was stuck in the thickets was a ram. Confusing. Until you come to Jesus. That ram was stuck in the thickets on the third day. The ram that Abraham took his son, instead of killing his son, there was a ram stuck in the thickets. It was the third day that Abraham saw that mountain. Jesus could have said, no, if you notice, Abraham got a ram, but I am the lamb. Behold the lamb who takes away the sin of the world. It was speaking of me, concerns me. When life sprouts from the earth, that's a reflection of me, Jesus could have said. I am the way, the truth, and the life. Right? Think about that study. As Jonah was in the belly of the great fish 3 days, 3 nights, so shall the Son of Man be, right? It's speaking of me. Jonah was speaking about me. That's just the third day alone. I love it when somebody comes to me and they say, you know, PC, that really spoke to me today. Could you imagine if Jesus Christ spoke to you? Could you imagine what kind of revelation Jesus could give us from the Scriptures? Trust me, all you'd want is more words of life when Jesus is opening it up to us. Amazing Bible study on that road that day. But the night is getting near. They finally get to Emmaus. Verse 28 says, the village drew near, and he indicated to them, I'm going to keep going, all right? I'm going to talk to you guys later. I hope you enjoyed the Bible study. And he was about to leave. Now, I find that intriguing, intriguing. Because there's no force on Jesus' part. He just says, all right, I'll see you later. He doesn't say, you know what, it's early. I still got another couple hours. You know, we got to sit down. I got to go over this stuff with you. I want to bake this into your life. I want to speak into your life. No, he said, I'll talk to you guys later. Hope you enjoy. Jesus is a gentleman. Jesus is a real, real gentleman. He never forces himself on anyone. If you want me to stay with you, I'll stay with you. I'll reveal more of myself to you. But it depends on you. If we draw near to God, He will draw near to us. That's how it works. He doesn't say, okay, sit down and I'm going to water you with the word. You're going to get this. No. He indicated he was going to go further. Jesus is a gentleman who must be invited into the home of our heart. There's no force from Jesus. And it says in verse 29, as I think all of us would have done if Jesus was speaking to us from the Scriptures, they held on to him. They constrained him, it says. They grabbed him. That's literally what it says. Oh, no, you're not going anywhere. I'm enjoying this word. I'm enjoying what you're sharing with us, Jesus. But they don't know it's Jesus. They say, come on, abide with us. It says there, it's evening anyway. It's far spent. He went in to stay with them. He was invited in and he went in. Just like Revelation chapter 3 would say, right? Behold, I stand at the door and I knock. If you ever seen the picture of Jesus at the door of a heart, of a home, knocking, if you look at that picture, there's no... The one who painted that picture is really beautiful because the door has no knob on the outside. Jesus, the only way that Jesus could get into that door is if we open. It's a kind of cool picture. You can all look it up, you know. There's no handle for him to open. We have to open the door. I will come in, Jesus says, and dine with him. If we hear his voice and we open the door, he will come in. Well, he sat at the table in verse 30, took bread. Now, I don't think this is communion necessarily. I think that this is not the communion supper. I think this is just a fellowship meal. They're sitting down. And he took it and he blessed it and he blessed it and he gave it to them and their eyes were open. Verse 31. Just like that, their eyes were open. And they knew him and he, mission accomplished. He vanished from their sight. And then they say, verse 32, didn't our heart burn as he talked to us, as he opened the scriptures to us? Didn't our hearts burn? Again, I think of all the places that Jesus could have expounded the scriptures to them and how their hearts could burn at the revelation that, holy moly, everything that we've ever read does point to Christ. That the Redeemer would come, like in Genesis chapter 3. The Passover that they celebrated all those years, they never realized this was about Jesus. Think about the Passover that Jesus could have walked them through, about the Lamb. Think about the wilderness experience in Numbers 21, that when Moses held up the serpent on the pole, and if you just looked at the pole, you would be spared from the biting vipers that were attacking the children of Israel in their wilderness journey. And Moses was instructed, build a serpent on a pole and hold it up, right? That's our medical sign today, right? If you look at medical signs, right? It's a serpent on a pole. Interesting. Why? Because that's what Moses made. And if you look at the serpent, it was a bronze serpent. Bronze is a picture of judgment. Jesus would one day be judged for our sins, and if we look at Jesus Christ, we will be saved. Same thing with the children of Israel. When Moses held up the thing, they were getting bit by vipers, and when they looked at the pole, they were saved, they were spared. Think about all the things that Jesus could have spoken about. Isaiah 53, the suffering servant. Psalm 22. Zechariah 13. They looked at him at whom was pierced. They were speaking of me. Guys, it was speaking of me, Jesus could have said. Could you imagine that Bible study? And when you come to that realization, don't be surprised if you get some heartburn, your burning heart. Not from a burrito, but your heart burns, right? It's. But one thing about Revelation, you need to be careful. When you start realizing this whole book is about Jesus and you start to understand how it's an integrated message system. It all starts to come together, you know, like a glove going on a hand. It all starts to make sense. You've got to be careful of one thing, and I just say this, right? Be careful of getting a big head. Stay with the big heart, the burning heart. Stay with the burning heart, but stay away from getting a big head. Because what happens is that when we get a big head with our understanding of the scriptures, we no longer start to share this great hope with others. We just get big heads. Nobody said it better than Paul, right? When he wrote to the church in Corinth, 1 Corinthians 8:1, knowledge puffs up, but love edifies, right? Knowledge just puffs you up. You can't walk out the door because you're such a Bible scholar. But love is what edifies. When we understand that this is all about Jesus, we fall in love with Jesus and we want to tell others. We don't become experts. We become lovers of God. I am a friend of God, we sang today. Beautiful song. When we are proud, we repel people. But when our hearts are on fire and we burn for God, we know that the scriptures and how they speak to us, it leads us to edify others. Note that these followers, with the burning heart, what did they do in verse 33? They ran back to Jerusalem. They hightailed it out and they ran back to Jerusalem. They found the 11, right, who were gathered together. And this to me is evidence that their lives are changed. They start to share with others the good news that we were with Jesus. This whole Bible speaks about Jesus Christ. They run back to the 11. They run back to Jerusalem. To what? To tell others. It's all confirmed. It's all real. It's all true. The good news. What's the good news? Verse 34, guys. The Lord is risen indeed. The Lord is risen indeed. And then they say, and he appeared over there to Simon. Simon, you saw him. You know it's real. The risen Lord always should lead us to a risen life. When we encounter the risen Jesus, it rises us above the sadness and the depression. Now, no doubt, some depression, some sadness is brought on by a chemical imbalance. I do believe that. But I believe much of depression is because we haven't encountered the risen Jesus Christ. A lot of depression is because we haven't come to Christ. Listen, says these followers, as they were having a meal with Jesus, he was known to them. Jesus comes alongside two discouraged saints, and just a meal and a fellowship, boy, it could change our lives. It's better than anything else I've ever encountered. A risen Lord. Getting high, getting drunk, it wears off. Still in the same boat. Getting $1,400 checks from the government, it'll be gone soon. Dating a new person will get old, and then you need to date a new person, that gets old, right? On and on and on. New job is great, and then it becomes a grind just like any other job. On and on it will always be. But when we sit down and listen to God through His Word, trust me, your heart will burn. Your heart will burn with gratitude, thankfulness that Jesus is near. And that is the point of the story, is it not? Jesus is near us. Jesus never leaves us, even when all looks so bleak. Jesus promised us in John 14:18, I will not leave you orphans, I will come to you. Jesus, He promised us this. He promised us. And this is indeed man's great fear, is it not? That we're going to be left alone. Every person who is dying in a sickbed, they're always the same thing. They just want to know that there's a hand there. All the time. But I always tell them, Jesus never leaves you. Jesus never leaves us on the road to despair and to think it over. It's all over. Nope, nope. Jesus walks alongside of us. So I close with this. Are you on a journey with Jesus? Have you started your journey with Jesus? Have you begun to open up the Scriptures? And I encourage everybody, just start to read the New Testament. Read the Gospels. Get to know this person of Jesus, because it's all about Him anyway. So you might as well get to know Him first, right? Study the Gospels. Let the Word of God speak to you. Are you on a journey with Jesus? If you are on a journey with Jesus, travel light. Travel light. Don't get so bummed out. Travel light. First following of Jesus, the risen Lord, believing in Him at His Word, Jesus would say to us in Matthew 11:28, come to me. Right? Come to me, all you who labor are heavy laden, I'll give you rest. And take my yoke upon you and learn from me. I find that interesting in Matthew 11, that it's the only time that Jesus said for us to learn anything from Him. It's the only time He actually said, I want you to learn this. Right? And what do we do? We do everything but. Jesus says to us, take my yoke upon you. Right? Travel light, He would say, right? Because the yoke of our own lives are like this, right? Oh man, life is hard. But Jesus would say, no, no, no. Take my yoke upon you, because why? It's light. It's light. This is all about me. Get to know me, Jesus would say to us. Get to know who I am. I love you so much. How much do you love me, Lord? I died for you. Get to know me. My yoke is easy and my burden is light. Right? Maybe you're sad here. You're walking through a difficult situation. Always remember, if you're a Christian here today, you gave your heart to the Lord Jesus Christ. Newsflash. You're never going to die. You're never going to die. because he is the resurrection and the life. Amen. You're never going to die. That's an easy yoke to bear. That is a light burden to walk around with. I'm never going to die. I know COVID has got a lot of people freaked out. I know. I get it. But if you're a Christian here today, let that burden go. Trust Jesus at his word. Believe all that the Bible says. Let go of that burden unto Jesus. And start to really believe in the resurrection, that he is alive and that he walks beside you forever and ever. You and I are never, ever alone as we walk this road to Emmaus. Amen? Amen. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this day's word. And God, we want to ask for your forgiveness, Lord, this morning. Forgive us of the times that we think so foolishly, that we really believe that it's all over. It's never going to be right. It's all bad. Lord, that's foolish thinking. We ask that you would strengthen our hearts to believe in all the scriptures, that they point to you, Lord. That you did exactly what you said you would do, Lord. You died for the sins of man. You are the propitiation of our sins, Lord. You took our sins upon your body. You died for us. And to prove that you were God, you came out of that tomb. And today, Lord, that tomb is empty. You have risen from the dead, Lord. And I pray for those that are discouraged at what life has thrown them. They were hoping. They were in the past tense. They thought that this would be a different life. They were hoping that this life would be better. But God, I pray that you would pour out your Spirit upon us all. That we would all be reminded, Lord, that you are indeed alive. It's indeed true. And that you would fill us with hope, Lord. We thank you for this day's word, Lord. And I pray for any that have yet to call upon your name, Jesus, and be saved. I pray that this would be the morning. That they would say, Jesus, forgive me of my sin, and I ask you to be my Lord. And save me today, Lord. I turn to you and I believe. I believe in your resurrection, Lord. I believe you came out of the grave. I believe that you are God. I believe that this story is real. Thank you so much, Jesus, for this morning. And please fill me with hope. I ask that you would baptize me this morning with the power of the Holy Spirit so that I can walk in fearlessness in this world. That I can walk in hope and have a joy to my step, Lord. That I am yours and you're alongside me and you'll never leave me. Thank you so much, God, this morning. Thank you for that. Thank you. Thank you that you're preparing a place called heaven for me. Thank you, Jesus. And thank you for this home. Thank you for this place that we can fellowship and we can hear your word. Thank you for all these gifts, Lord Jesus. Set our hearts on fire. We pray these things in your precious name. Amen. 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 Before the closing song, I just want to pray a blessing upon us all. May the Lord bless you and I. May the Lord make his face to shine upon us all. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon us and may he give us all peace. I pray that the Lord would fill us with his divine peace in knowing that he is indeed with us. He walks with us and we're never alone. And Jesus, I pray that we would all travel lighter in this world. Help us this week to not let the cares of this world choke what you're doing in our life. Set us free, Lord. May we truly enjoy your presence. We love you and we thank you for this day's work. We look forward to Easter, God. We praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Lord bless you guys. Let's sing a closing song. Thank you, Tom.
Consider all the worlds thy hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the roaring thunder, thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God his Son, not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in, that on the cross my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
When Christ shall come,
when Christ shall come, with shout of acclamation, and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart.
shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art.
Then sings my soul.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art. How great thou art. How great thou art.
So that's it, guys. Have a great week. Be blessed. And we'll see you next time.
Where to stand?